At Metal Man Fabs, our range is vast, but our specialty is fully automated gates. Whatever you need created in metal, we're here to create amazing bespoke designs just for you. Our motto is simple. Our only limitation is your imagination. For examples, contact and details, including some outstanding customer feedback, go to metalmanfabs.co.uk or email us at info@metalmanfabs.co.uk. Remember, our only limitation is your imagination. Metal Man, Coventry.
In the mix, live and streaming around the world.
Duggystone Radio.
There you go. We're back with Stuart Howes in the building, the celebrity hypnotherapist.
You would have thought we might dance and it was Rick Astley then, wouldn't you?
Whoa. I love Peter Andre. I love him. I love him as an individual. I think he's... I'd like to meet him because I think he's... I do. Whenever I've seen him, and you can't always take people on face value, can you? What we see... We talk about this a lot, and people you see... we portray this image of what we want people to see us as. But I genuinely look at him and think, no, I think you're quite genuine in the way you are. I think you're genuine in the way...
You know what? I never thought I'd say this, because, you know, like you say, like when you meet people, it's always, like you said, different to the television version of them. The television perception of Peter Andre does not do him justice. He is even nicer, even more genuine in real life.
Yeah, and they make him out to be something, but when I've seen him in certain things, you think, I think you're a genuinely nice guy, and I think he's been shafted on various fronts from various people in the past. But anyway, that's another subject. So, what's your future plans? What you're currently working on? Hang on a minute. Let's rewind a little minute because you've got the beanie on. I'm playing that next. Do you know what I mean? It's like a seamless link, isn't it? Let's rewind, Bowl Selector. What the hat you've got on, the beanie? What's that all about? Tell us that again.
So, well, this is Ross Birkinshaw has a boxing club. He helps people in Sheffield. He trains kids to box. He trains anyone like boxer size. Absolutely brilliant. He is.
Yeah.
But he's a really good friend of mine because I ended up working with him in the last chapter of his boxing career. So he made a comeback. I think he lost like 4 or 5 fights in his comeback. Everyone wrote him off. I helped him for his last 6 fights. And in those 6 fights, he won the Commonwealth title, the WBO European title, fought for a world title eliminator. So if he would have won that fight, he would have been fighting for a world title.
Right.
And he was 3 rounds up. I think in the third round, he was definitely 2 rounds up, and in the third round, he injured himself. He done his elbow in, and he had to pull out, and he never fought again. Oh, and he was literally 36 minutes away from a world title shot. Absolute heartbreaking at the time.
Yeah, it's a shame when that happens, because obviously you can have all the mindset in the world, but if physically something goes wrong like that, like a limb or something, then you're a bit goose. So I presume what you did then, you've helped him... psyched him up for the fight then, and was that what you was responsible for?
I've got him in the zone. So when you're in the zone, you're literally fighting at your best all the time. So he's already got the skills, so I didn't need to worry about that. All you do is make sure that he's fighting at his best of every second of every round, and he will beat people that you just couldn't imagine. And he became amazing. He was ranked 8th in the world with the WBO, ranked 11th with the IBF, and it was just an amazing journey for me, because I also helped someone called Kev Hooper and Chris Billings-Smith, who Kev Hooper was the only guy from Grimsby to win an English title. He fought for a British title. Chris Billings-Smith is fighting for a British title in March, I think, on Sky Sports. I'm at the moment working with Navid Mansouri, who fought for the WBA Intercontinental title. Sounds more like a WWE bloody title.
Yeah.
But he fought for that. You know, it was like a ranked 20th in the world title, again on Sky Sports. You know, I'm a lucky guy. You know, I love it. You know, I get to work with these people that fight on BBC, Sky Sports, work with footballers on BT Sport, Sky Sports pay-per-view, you name it. It's just amazing, little old me, involved in all this magic, you know?
Yeah, well, at the end of the day, that's good, man. It's good. And I presume as you get going with that, it's like a lot of things, isn't it? One person will speak... celebrities or a group of people, whether it's musicians or it's sports people, they will gravitate towards each other because they're in that arena. So I should imagine that, you know, they talk to each other, and that's how things can spin off, how you get one from the next.
Yeah, it's mad because, like, when I moved to Wales, obviously no one knew who I was. So it went from Stuart Howe to Stuart Who. But what happened was is the boxing world, there's a lot of Welsh boxers that knew of me anyway. So it was just like getting in touch with them and saying, look, I know no one. Can you help me out?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, there's big trainers, big boxers that I've been in talks with already. Within 6 months of living, obviously lockdown has sodded it all up. But now within 6 months of living over here, I was meeting big names in Wales. So it didn't take long because, like you said, you're in that circle. You know, once you're in that circle and you've been mentioned over 5, 6, 7 years, people realise that you can do a good job. And it's weird because I was in, like, you're talking about this clubhouse thing, and sorry to go back to it, but I worked with someone, not allowed to mention their name, but they're worth like just under £10 million.
Yeah.
They don't have yachts, they don't, and I said, how come? Like, don't get me wrong, he's got a nice house and car, like literally really nice house, really nice car. But even then it wasn't a Lamborghini or anything. I said, how comes you haven't got the yacht, the this? And he said, because you can rent them out for a day for like not much. And he said, and don't believe what you see on social media. He said, because you can rent a private jet for, oh, it's a lot of money for the day, but you can rent, like, literally, like, you told me to look it up, and you can rent, if you have four people, you can rent like a brand new Ferrari for like 2 days for about £6,000.
Yeah.
It's not a big, I mean, it's a lot, but two, you know.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen that. Definitely, I've seen that before because, you know, you can hire all sorts of stuff. And why, if anyone's got anything about them, unless you're flying, flying all the time, why would you have a Learjet? You know what I mean? Unless you are flying every week. I get it if someone is in business and needs to fly from New York to London all the time and they're doing the business on the plane and all. I get that. It makes absolute sense, 100%, to have your own space and you can do, because time is money, you can still do your business while you're actually moving around. I get that. But if you just need one every now and then or for the sake of it, I think that's where a lot of artists, musicians lose out because they get this big success and then spend it either on, well, they spend it on all sorts of stuff, don't they? So stuff that, but you know what I'm saying, don't you? They spend it on the stuff we shouldn't be spending it on. But they think it's going to be there forever. I think a lot of people think stuff's going to be there. Oh, I'm always going to be successful. I'm always going to be famous. It can end tomorrow. So always have something in the bank to back you up. But you're right about renting stuff. Why would there's? I watched a thing a bit back. You know, like you look at the yachts that are over in wherever Marbella or wherever they go. You know, all the yachts. You know, the people probably never on them. Probably on them once a year, if that. Some people buy them, never even get on them. They spend millions on them, on these yachts. It's crazy.
Oh, it's mad. Like, it's like people were saying to me, I know it's totally different, but people were saying to me last year, like, oh, you're so lucky. And the year before, like, because I was going to the beach all the time. And they're like, I don't know how you can afford it. I was like, I live in an hour and eight radius, because I'm in Wales now. I live in an hour and eight radius from 15 beaches or 17 beaches. So for me to go to beaches on a Wednesday, for example, I'm not spending any money. I'm spending petrol money.
Yeah.
That's it. And people go, no, it's all right for you always time off on the beach. It's like, well, it's once a week. It's not. Like, yeah, but you've been on it 20 times this year. It's because I live near it. It's like you going to the shops.
Yeah, or the park.
You know, within an hour and eight radius, I can go, which beach today? That one, that one, that one, that one. And it's not. And the thing is, I do make it clear on my social media, this is not a beach lifestyle. It's once a week.
Yeah.
People go, like, the first time they notice it's once a week. But after about 20, 30 times, they go, see, live, like, is it a beach lifestyle? It's like, seriously. It's like, no, I'm not going abroad. I'm not.
Yeah.
And people get it mixed up, you know, they go, oh, it's all right for you, you're lucky. But it's not. I'll go there for like a Wednesday morning for a cup of tea, like, you know. It's,
yeah,
like,
and that's up to people, isn't it? You know, they see stuff like that. Well, if that's what you want to do, you do the same. I mean, we live the furthest away from the ocean you can, which me and my wife sort of don't like in some respects, because I don't know what it is about the sea and living near the sea. I miss that in some respects, being a bit closer. We're, you know, right in the centre. So it's we always gravitate towards, you know, the hills and the beaches, and Wales is fantastic for that. Apart from from the rain,
love
man,
it.
The rain, that's about it. But you know what I mean?
Rain's in the summer, mate. Honestly, I went to Mumbles and with my girlfriend because she's Welsh, she's from Merthyr, hence why, well, you know,
yeah,
you obviously know through N and that, but you know, this is why I moved, because it's just so cheap here, mate. Honestly, it's like I live in a 3-bedroom house at the moment with an attic room, and it's about £250 a month cheaper than a 1-bedroom flat in Hemel. It's like,
yes.
You can't be skint in Wales if you got it right, you know?
Yeah, I like the Mumbles. Yeah, I like that. I've been there. Fantastic
love
place.
Love
I think we'll have another track. I think we'll play, because obviously people might not know, but the E17 lineup, we've mentioned it before in one of the pre-order videos, is it's a new lead singer, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah,
the Artful Dodger.
Brilliant.
The Artful Dodger. And the Artful Dodger was in a song with Craig Davies, and this his career nearly ended because of Bow Selector, didn't it? Come on, Kaz, Rink, EY.
Yeah, so I was a kid then, so apparently it actually nearly ended his career. Like,
no,
I remember being a kid laughing, but
David Manoogian really ruined his career because he basically made him out to be his caricature image and took the ripped it out of him, and it nearly, you know, a bit bow got me, my Kaz, come on, Kaz. Go and have a look at some of the videos. It nearly destroyed him. It's hilarious, but yeah, it's not good, is it? It just shows you how your career can be taken down by that sort of stuff. So anyway, this is the new lead singer for E17. It's Artful Dodger singing with Craig David. Rewind. Here we go.